This PowerPoint is about conversion factors. Conversion factors are units that we use that are related to one another that allow us to convert one measured quantity into another measured quantity. We get these type of relationships all the time. They're in the problem. Sometimes you have to tease them out a little bit. For instance, 65 miles per hour tells me certain things. It tells me that 65 miles are equal to 1 hour. One way of expressing this in terms of how we're going to be doing our math is to write these as ratios. We can always write these as ratios if they're equivalent to one another. So according to this, 65 miles is equal to 1 hour. Or I could say that 1 hour is equal to 65 miles. So I can write these as a ratio. I can always use these in this manner as long as they're stated as being equal to one another. Per is another way of saying equals. One other equality that comes up quite often is the number of centimeters in an inch. There are 2.54 centimeters in 1 inch. And we can write that conversion factor as 2.54 centimeters is equal to 1 inch, or vice versa, with the 1 inch over the 2.54 centimeters. So getting a handle on these conversion factors is a big deal in being able to work the math in chemistry. Same with the relationship between inches and feet. There are 12 inches in 1 foot, or I can say 1 foot is equal to 12 inches. And I put little stars after this because I know that these are exact quantities. And sometimes I make a note to myself, because you remember in a previous PowerPoint that I said that I treat exact quantities as if they have an infinite number of significant figures. So any exact quantity is not going to limit the number of significant figures that I have in my answer when I'm doing a calculation. Sometimes these relationships are a little more hidden. So sometimes they, you know, refer to you needing to know the minutes in an hour. Maybe they don't even tell you that you're going to need this, but you should be aware that any calculation involving time, you may need to convert between minutes, hours, and seconds. So in this one, for the relationship between minutes and hours, it's 60 minutes is 1 hour, or 1 hour is 60 minutes. And I again put stars after these to remind myself that these are exact quantities. Metric relationships are used quite a bit. We need to convert quite often between things like kilograms and grams, or kilograms and milligrams. So this is kind of a list of how these are related to one another. I always give a list that resembles something like this on exam, so you don't need to memorize all of these metric relationships. I'm sure a few people are breathing a deep sigh of relief at that. I don't know that it's all that useful to memorize this. It shouldn't, you know, and by the end of the semester, you'll probably have, you know, a few of these, you know, down. You'll have accidentally memorized them. Okay, the unit doesn't matter whether it's in the previous one. We were doing meters, now we're using grams. So the relationship works the same. 1 kilometer is equal to 1,000 meters. 1 kilogram is equal to 1,000 grams. So these prefixes work the same no matter what the base unit is. In another previous PowerPoint, we talked about scientific notation. So you can see that once we get up around 1,000 and bigger, maybe it's useful to use scientific notation. So all of these could be written out as scientific notation. All of these relationships can be written as ratios, just like we did before with the miles per hour. So 1 kilogram is equal to 1 × 10³ grams, or 1,000 grams. And likewise, 1,000 grams is equal to 1 kilogram. And I left the 1 out there, but it should be there. Likewise, 1 gram is equal to a million milligrams, or 10⁶. Let me back up again here. 1 gram is equal to 1 × 10⁶ micrograms, and 1 × 10⁶ micrograms is equal to 1 gram. Percentages are often used in science to express how one quantity is related to the whole. So I've got a bunch of percentages that I kind of pulled from the web again here. I found that the average body fat of an 18-year-old male is 22.9%. So that means 22.9 relative to the whole, the 100%. And we can express this, if we're talking about mass, we can talk about 22.9 grams of fat per 100 grams of body mass. Or we could write that the other way around, 100 grams of body mass per 22.9 grams of fat. Or depending upon the units that we're actually using in the problem, we could use kilograms as our ratio, or pounds, or stones, or any crazy unit that we would like to use. Okay, water is 88.9% oxygen, so I can express that as grams of oxygen per 100 grams of water as a total. So it's 88.9 grams of oxygen for every 100 grams of water, or I could say 100 grams of water is equivalent to 88.9 grams of oxygen. One thing to look out with in percentages is sometimes there's a hidden relationship. So they'll give you the percentage of oxygen and then ask you about the percentage of hydrogen. So since water is only made out of oxygen and hydrogen, I can subtract the 88.9 from 100. So when I do that, I get 11.1% hydrogen. So I could also write for this that 11.1 grams of hydrogen is equal to 100 grams of water. So I can use these as another conversion factor. So look out for the hidden conversion factor. So just keep your antenna up for that. And then another one here. I've got 5 grams of iron for every 100 grams of crust, and vice versa. 100 grams of crust should yield 5 grams of iron. So I can go out in my yard and scoop up 100 grams of soil and hopefully end up with 5 grams of iron. Maybe or maybe not. This is an average expressed over the whole surface of the planet, so who knows. So that's a little bit about conversion factors. The next up, we'll be talking about how to use these conversion factors to help us solve long word problems. My daughter is in science in high school, and she referred to these long problems as LAPS. And I'll just leave you to figure out what that acronym LAP is for. L stands for long. P stands for problem, A is a dirty word, so that's what she thought of those LAPS.